This is CUNY TV, the City University of New York.
Hello, I'm Ronnie Eldridge. Welcome to Eldridge & Company. I can't remember a time when state legislatures have tried so hard to deny the rights that citizens are born with. Fortunately for us, New York is not among them. Liz Krueger is a New York state senator, and as far as I'm concerned, one of the very best state representatives in the country. And I can think of no one better to talk with about all of this. So welcome to the first of our Decision 2012 programs, and greetings to you.
Thank you so much, Ronnie.
Is New York State, are the conservatives in New York State going to ever be powerful enough to do to us what they've done in other states?
I think we need to be really vigilant, and we need to actually fight back, because here in New York City, I think people would be shocked to learn that there's a Tea Party movement all over the state of New York. I have legislative colleagues who are far, far more conservative Republicans than 10 years ago when I first got to the state Senate. And in fact, most of the primary action right now in the state is between Republicans challenging that the legislators are not conservative enough for them.
Boy, so that is a real danger.
Yes, I think
it's so obvious that we can trace to all the different states that are passing all these repressive measures, whether it's women's health or whether access to the ballots, that's because of the conservative Tea Party, I guess.
Well, and it's a tie in between the conservatives, the Tea Party, the moneyed interests who have decided, for whatever their reasons, whatever their social opinions, that it's easier to control conservative people in legislative office.
What moneyed interests would be interested in representatives from New York State?
Well, again, there's a whole world of anti-choice money that is spreading out capital by capital, state by state, trying to move legislation that challenges Roe v. Wade or basically makes it so impossible for healthcare providers to continue to operate that you have a default end of access to reproductive health.
You've organized
healthcare.
A whole group, or what do you call it?
I founded the New York State Bipartisan Pro-Choice Legislative Caucus. It's a mouthful, but basically saying New York State was the first state in the country to recognize women's rights to private health care decisions pre-Roe v. Wade. In fact, a Republican was the critical vote on the floor of the assembly, there you go, to make sure we had choice and that we're not going back. And I have watched over the last 2 years as state by state, horrendous legislation gets passed into law. But not here, but we have to be vigilant. Yeah. So there are 79 members now of the caucus, and we're making it clear we're not allowing ourselves to go backwards. But tax policy also is an enormously complex issue where people just sometimes their eyes glaze over, well, we just think we pay too much taxes, but they don't get into the details about who's paying the taxes. And if you allow large corporations and the wealthiest New Yorkers not to have to pay any taxes, guess what? You do. You have to pay the taxes.
Oh, absolutely. Right.
And so people don't see it that way until it hits them in the face.
But are there any national corporate corporations that would be interested in things? Do we have any?
Well, there's a group called ALEC, A-L-E-C, and they've gotten, you know, some bad flack in the press. So some of their corporate sponsors have pulled out because there's been enough publicity, but there's other organizations like that. I mean, we have the Koch brothers right here in New York who fund huge amount of private money to direct who are the legislators.
But isn't there any kind of, what's the election law for that in the state?
Well, the election law for that in the state is incredibly loose. We have some of the wild, wild west, anything goes election laws
in
New York State.
Nothing like New York City.
We don't have public financing. Yeah. We have almost no campaign finance reform. And in fact, our problem is the Board of Elections never even looks in or follows the challenges. So someone might object that somebody's given someone way too much money. but maybe 10 years later you'll get a letter saying, oh, we'll look into that. So yes, we should be concerned here in New York.
Are there any attempts to introduce legislation, or is there?
Yes, and the Governor Cuomo has said that he is committed to campaign finance reform and public financing as one of his next big issues. I am strongly supporting that. I believe we have to have public financing in New York State and the rest of the country, because I worry we won't have democracy in another 10 years.
Absolutely, it's very threatening. It is, it's incredible. And also just the television, all the advertising is just...
I know. Well, we should do public financing and required public access TV.
Exactly.
Right? Yeah. We could turn this country around, I think, literally in a year or two if we just did those two things.
So in addition to the movement, there's also a great danger, it seems to me, in the Republican platform and proposals that we see coming out about how we're going to balance the budget or make up the deficit or we're going to cut programs, right? What one of the things is the block grants, and I would like you to describe what block grants mean. And, and let's discuss how they came.
So there are a number of federal programs where the formula for how much money the federal government has to pay to each state or each beneficiary is based on some evaluation of need and real costs. So New York might get less money than California, because it's, you know, California's the largest state, and it's based on population and demographics for age and poverty and other realities. But in a block grant, they simply say there'll be X amount of money, no matter how many people who are eligible or the need, and then we'll just divvy it up on some block grant formula. And so if New York State, you've been actually receiving X amount per year because you have, say you have 16% of the population in the country in need, you've been seeing 16% of the resources under a block grant, you could see your numbers plummet. And in fact, the history of block grants from the federal government to states is in fact to see a reduction in federal dollars and many more restrictions on what a state can do. So if here we are in New York, we are a proud progressive blue state. We were ahead of the curve on many programs in history, and we have really great programs. People still complain about them, but if they look at the other 49 states, we have some great programs. Under a block grant scenario, states like New York, Massachusetts, Illinois would be the most likely to take the biggest hits. So let's say the Medicaid program. It's the largest federal health care insurance program, separate than Medicare, because Medicare is a national guarantee, at least now under the current president. But Medicaid is a state match and there's state options.
Is that what we used to call revenue sharing?
It's a type of revenue sharing. Yeah. So New York State has Medicaid where we provide home health care. We provide senior citizens who may not have actually been in poverty, but now are elderly, are disabled, need help in order to stay in their own homes. We use a Medicaid program to pay for that.
In addition to that, for nursing home stays.
Exactly. If it was block granted, we all assume that those programs would go completely away and Medicaid would not pay for home care attendance or possibly for nursing homes. And we would have overnight 40, 50, 60,000 people in the state unable to stay in their own homes and unable to actually pay to go somewhere else. So it's really sort of a nightmare scenario if the Paul Ryan budget became the budget of the country. Now, of course, Paul Ryan is running with Mitt Romney as VP, and after he was announced as VP, everybody on the Republican side seemed to want to get very quiet about what Paul Ryan actually stands for and the proposals he's made. And yet, if you listen to the Republicans, well, once they get in, they're going to follow all of Paul Ryan's recommendations. And really, ask anyone in government budgeting what that means for each state in the nation, particularly a state like New York. We won't know what hit us. We literally won't know what hit
us. But block grants is a favorite thing with Romney, aside from the Ryan budget, isn't it? It's a concept he talks about. If he's going to combine federal agencies, education with this and that, and right?
Well, because he basically says we want the federal government out of running program. So if you block grant and do away with federal agencies, you're writing a check to each state and saying, okay, guys, you're on your own. Now it'll be a much smaller check than you were getting before from various federal programs, but you in theory then don't need a lot of federal government, right? You get to shrink that government, right, and put that in the bath and drown it. And then you say to all the states, hey, you're on your own. Oh, if the money doesn't go far enough, well, we're giving you the authority to change all the rules. So create new programs, do away with programs. We won't tell you you have to keep running them. And so what it does is it starts the sort of race to the bottom of states actually being thrown under the bus by the federal government, not having the resources to continue the programs themselves, and then being pushed again, if you allow Republican conservatives to take over state houses as well, to end these programs state by state.
Well, it's also a disaster for the country. I mean, it ends the democracy of the country. If you're living in a state, I mean, it's unheard. It leaves me kind of speechless, because if you're living in a state where you're not getting enough money to provide the services you need, then if you need more money, you're going to increase taxes, and if you don't increase taxes, you're certainly not going to provide. What happens? I mean, what happens with states that have more poor people living in them? What happens with states that have more people? It's the whole question of the inability of the government to respond to the needs of the people, which is so basic to the Democrats.
Well, right? and there's history.
And to Republicans, I think.
So. There's research showing how bad this is. So when George Bush was the governor of Texas, before he was the president of the United States, right, he tried to radically reduce the size of Texas government and reduce the taxes. And so Texas went from having a public education system, you know, I think it was sort of close to the middle of the 50 states, to the worst system in the country. So yes, there's cause and effect. If you defund public education, you get lousy public education. If you defund health care, people don't get taken care of. People get sicker, right? If you do away with programs for senior citizens at the same time as the demographics of the country, whether we like it or not, is skewing heavily to senior citizens being a larger and larger percentage.
Why don't we like it? I mean, it means so people like me can live longer.
Well, exactly.
And you.
Exactly.
Right.
So, no,
but
I mean,
I know what you mean.
In a perfect world, we have an average number. We really are having difficulty adjusting
to this whole new thing, because it's incredible. Child care. Now, is the history of child care and the reason that it has never become what some of us have always wanted, universal child care or affordable child care for everybody, is that been the result of the funding sources and the way it's been done?
Yes, I think combined with the schizophrenia in this country of, on the one hand, thinking everybody should be out there working and being self-sufficient, right, particularly poor women, and on the other hand, thinking, but women are supposed to stay home and take care of their kids. So there's always been this weird mixed messaging, at least in my entire lifetime, of whether government should really be expanding quality child care programs or whether government should actually be supporting women to stay home with their children. I think mostly the supporting women to stay home with their children is when it's the message and when they don't actually want to put money into child care. But it is, of course, a huge issue in today's economy where we're facing a 10% unemployment rate and more and more challenges for
anyone to stay in the workforce. Households with two earning
partners, right? So you have to talk about child care. But yes, in block grant models, it's very unlikely we will be able to continue the funding.
Because there are more than one. There's more than one need in that block grant, right? So that sometimes money is taken from this group to that group.
Well, we even did it, yes. So even in the state level, we have block granted, because of the feds from earlier decisions, money to serve at-risk youth. So there wasn't enough money when they merged them together. So then the court said, you have to prioritize money that goes to follow-up care for kids who've gotten in trouble. Well, then half the university said, well, then we're not doing any preventive services anymore. And preventive services for kids who are at risk means they're never going to have to enter the judicial system. They're never going to end up having to go into an alternative to incarceration or a a youth prison setting. So let's focus on preventive service. Now, a lot of the experts say, yes, that's right, except with the funding we now have available, it all goes at the back end, and there's no money available for prevention. So those are the kinds of, cut the baby down the middle scenarios that happen when you say, okay, you're supposed to do everything, but we're giving you a lot less money. And those are very, very real issues for communities. And then, of course, if the feds cut what they give to the states cut what they give to the localities. So then New York City government screams, Albany, what are you doing to us? And I get it, and I agree. Mm-hmm. And I go, well, take a look at what Paul Ryan plans on cutting to state governments. You're going to be really mad at Albany.
Happened recently, didn't it, with the rent subsidies?
Yes. That was one relatively small example with a huge impact.
Right.
Right.
Let's talk about that. Describe it.
Okay. So the city had a program to provide rent subsidies for families who had been in the shelter system, who then they moved into apartments they couldn't possibly afford without a supplemental assistance from government. So it was a relatively successful program. There were still plenty of flaws, and in fact, many of the advocates felt because it phased out so quickly, you were setting up families for a failure where you'd move them into an apartment, you'd reduce the subsidy even if they couldn't possibly increase their wages, and then they'd end up falling back into the shelter system again. So it was a flawed program, but it was a program that was clearly moving X number of families with children out of the shelters to apartments. Then there was a funding fight over how much the state would give the city. The city used that, either some people think just as an excuse to get them out of the program, others say they really didn't have the money. You know, everything's always fungible in government budgeting, but the city declared they were stopping the program. So they stopped the program. So now we have a skyrocketing rate of families with children in the shelter system. I think it's 19,000 children are in
the highest, I think, ever since they started counting.
Right.
Yeah.
And there's nobody leaving the shelter system because
Section 8 is no longer.
Section 8 has such huge waiting lists, and the federal government has continued, to maybe hold harmless, but watch it slowly die. I don't believe Section 8 exists under a Ryan budget model.
I'm sure it doesn't, right.
So we really, for one small program change, we saw an enormous new crisis in growing numbers of homeless families.
What happens, who pays for the homeless, the shelters?
The shelters is, ironically, you can get federal money to pay for a significant portion of shelters, but not federal money to pay for apartments,
right.
Even though, of course, keeping a family in a shelter is far more expensive than their own apartment and does
harmful.
Enormous psychological and emotional damage to all of them.
So all of these programs come back down to preventive assistance to prevent the further disasters that are
exactly
going to come.
Exactly.
And food stamps. You know, I should tell the viewers that we should talk about it. You are one of the, poverty has always been your major interest, I think.
Yes, I spent 20 years of my life working on anti-poverty programs and running not-for-profits.
You're the person that we've always come to for help and for explanations, and that's what we're doing here.
Because I did a lot of work on the food and nutrition programs.
Right. And
yes.
Food stamps.
Yes, food stamps, which is the largest and most successful anti-hunger program in this country. And no one wishes more Americans to have to be on food stamps, but thank goodness we had the program over the last several years because we saw our economy, plummeting, more and more unemployed people, and at least they could turn to the non-block granted entitlement food stamp, which means if another million Americans are eligible tomorrow, another million Americans get food stamps. If we block granted that, I can't even imagine what the scene would look like in poor communities. So food stamps is an incredibly successful program. It basically gives you a debit card to go and buy food. So when another New Yorker, if unfortunately too poor to take care of their own needs, receives food stamps, they then go to the food store or the farmer's market and buy food.
And
that food store then hires more people to sell food.
Contributes to the economy.
That farmer sells more food to the right?
Right, and everybody's
manufacturers in the store. So it's a economic development, yeah, win-win, targeted to the exact communities and the exact right people who need it most. It's a fabulous program, and yet
it's at risk.
I don't even understand how this Republican group.
Is it in the agricultural bill?
It is, yes.
And that's the one that we have read recently that may not be taken up until the end of the year?
Yes.
If then.
And in fact, the Republicans made a large, large effort to radically reduce the dollar amount right for food stamps in the agricultural budget bill.
The same theory or the same result came when state governments, in an effort to cut their costs, laid off people, because these were people then who weren't contributing to the general economy, right?
Exactly.
And then on the receiving end of assistance, maybe.
Well, that's always the catch, right? If you take people and increase unemployment when they really have no other options, all you're doing is creating a larger problem for yourself to try to deal with. Yeah, so I always feel very strongly that government needs to think once, twice, three times before they even imagine reducing their workforce during times of bad economy, bad job opportunities.
So what do you think it takes to elect people who are farsighted and have goals that would really change the system?
Well, again, I would start with public financing of campaigns. It would turn around, I believe, almost immediately who was directing the money to the types of candidates they wanted to see. I think there was a recent citizen action report that in New York State, all political giving is done by less than 0.5% of the population.
Democracy, and now it's worse. Now,
right. Democracy needs to be participatory in order to survive, including participatory of who are you actually choosing to be the candidates to then make decisions that we all live under. So public financing, for all the flaws people talk about in the New York City system, works far better than any other system I have seen in democracy. It would not be expensive to implement in the state of New York. It would still end up being the equivalent of a few dollars per New Yorker to ensure a fair playing field for people, get rid of TV advertising, and make a couple of cable channels 24/7 political channels where you would have to follow rules of honesty, but you could do debates and you could do presentations, and people who wanted to could sit there and watch and learn from you instead of spending millions and millions and millions of dollars to buy TV ads. Let's be honest, we've both been in politics. Did you ever learn anything really about a candidate from the TV ads? No. You know, they sell you soda pop, they sell you burgers, yeah, and they sell you candidates. That's not the way to learn.
And also, the basic concept is that the public owns that airwaves.
That's right. So we can do it easily.
And these are people who are making a lot of money.
That's right.
And it just compounds the irony, and it doesn't make sense at all.
I mean, in New York State, for governor, controller, or attorney general, our three statewide elections, you can give them $60,000 each per person. So imagine you're a person with a spouse, that's $120,000. Then in your business, you ask your five other business partners to each give them $60,000.
And we saw the results of that with the Allen Hevesy scandal, where the controller then was rewarding those people.
That's right. Because really, when somebody's giving you $300,000, $400,000, do you think they get a little more attention? I think they do.
Yeah.
Even if you were trying your absolute best to never even know who your donors are, this system doesn't work.
So is there any state in the country that has any public financing?
There are. There's several states. And I'm embarrassed to say I don't remember right this second. Right. But there are at least two states with public financing. We have the problem of the Citizens United Supreme Court decision that has said corporations are the equivalent of individuals. And again, it's sort of, you shook your head like, really? But they're not.
Yes,
the
right
people who work in them are each an individual, but the corporation has the, I don't know, God-given inalienable right to have no limitations on how much money they put into elections. I don't know where the Supreme Court was that morning, but in fact, that decision has done real harm to the ability of states or the federal system to put realistic, reasonable limitations on. There's a huge problem of no transparency. So there's all these secret 501c4s and the super duper PACs where literally, you know, a couple of individuals can be putting, you know, I'm not even just talking millions, potentially hundreds of millions of dollars into campaigns. I mean, Sheldon Adelson of current fame, talking about spending $100 million, which could be petty cash for him, but could certainly change the outcome of a presidential election.
Talking about this, though, also the question is, we just recently have had redistricting. Now, you used to represent what district, the Senate district?
The 26th district. And
is that still the 26th?
No, it will be the 28th district as of January.
And let's discuss that, because we haven't had any reform of that system either, have we?
No, we really had a disaster in Albany in 2012. So the plan that was submitted by the majorities in each house and accepted by the governor allows for the worst gerrymandering of Senate districts in the history of New York State. And our state was already infamous for gerrymandering.
Which means drawing uneven lines
to advantage certain parties or certain people rather than the actual rules in the Constitution, ensuring that communities of common need and commonalities are brought together. This gerrymandering prevented communities of color in Suffolk County and Nassau County from being able to be together in any Senate district.
And are there any federal law cases against it or appeals for?
What we have found, and we tried, was that the courts are really not interested in challenging the legislature, particularly once a governor signs off. So I believe if the governor had said, this is not acceptable, I reject it, go back to scratch, the legislature then wouldn't have done the right thing and a court would have come in to draw the lines. And with fair lines, we would have a very different set of Senate boundaries. I think the assembly, ironically, would have stayed pretty much the same. Because again, it's such a Democratic state that a Democratic majority in the assembly can actually pretty much follow the rules and still end up having, you know, districts that they think are legitimate to run in.
Well, we've come to the end of our half hour. So I appreciate it so much. And you've just drawn such attention to the relationship between the federal government and the state and the need for a better kind of politics, and I hope you're going to be a leader of it forever.
Forever?
Thank you, Liz Krueger.
Thank you, Ronnie.
Is there any people you'd like to hear and topics you'd like us to explore? Please let me know. You can write to me at CUNY TV, 365 Fifth Avenue, New York, New York, 10016. Or you can go to the website at cuny.tv and click on Contact Us. I look forward to hearing from you.